لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. Brother Chairman, brothers and sisters in Surah Al-Afal, we praise and thank Allah for the opportunity to be with you here tonight. And we pray that our session here tonight may be blessed by Him and that it may be of benefit to all, inshallah. Dajjal's deadliest weapon. Who is Dajjal? And why does he have weapons? Who gave him the weapons? And what is he using the weapons for? This subject belongs to a branch of knowledge known as Akhirul Zaman, Ilm Akhirul Zaman. But in the English language, it's called Islamic Eschatology. It is by far the most important branch of knowledge in your Islamic university. By far the most important branch of knowledge now to be taught in any institution of Islamic learning is Islamic eschatology, the Islamic view of Akhirul Zaman, of the last age. We have a wealth of information in the Quran and in the Ahadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is required is that we must be able to interpret that information and to apply it in the world in which we live today. The companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam were sitting talking amongst themselves when he, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, came and asked, "What are you talking about?" And they said, "We're talking about alamat as-sa'ah, the signs of the last day." And then he said, and the hadith is in Sahih Bukhari, it is in Sahih Muslim, the last day would not come until, he mentioned 10 signs. And these are known as the 10 major signs of the last day. In addition to these 10, there are many others. Women would be dressed and yet be naked. Women would dress like men. So the night wants to become day. Men would dress like women. So your baby boys are going to grow up behaving like girls. Go ahead eating all those hormones and so on. See what's going to happen. There are many, many other signs than these 10. The 10 are, and by now you should have memorized them, but I don't have the time to test you. Number one, and these signs have not been given in the order in which they will occur. So we're giving them to you randomly. Number one, Dajjal. Al-Masih al-Dajjal. Number two, Gog and Magog. Ya'juj and Ma'juj. And incidentally, there's scarcely any proper literature on the subject. written in the modern age. It is not uncharitable on my part to say, because I have attended 5 universities and I am now knocking on the door of 70 years of age, so there are some liberties I can take. It is not uncharitable for me to say that most of the literature that you find written in the modern age on these subjects is worthy of being sent on a one-way ticket to Disneyland. You know where Disneyland? Meaning it's not scholarly. It's not scholarly. So number one, Dajjal. Number two, Gog and Magog. Number three, the return of the Son of Mary. Perhaps if you turn off this fan, we might get less static here. Number three, the return of the Son of Mary. Number four, Dukhan, smoke, which I am of the opinion should be visible, I think, 20, 25 years from now. But of course, I can be mistaken. But when you see that smoke up there, you know most of mankind will not survive. There will only be few people left on the earth. Number five, Dabbatul Ard. Dabbatul Ard, a creature, beast of the earth, or the land. Number six, that the sun will rise from the west. Number seven, eight, and nine, three, Khusuf, plural of Khas, a shaking of the earth, movement of the earth, accompanied by a sinking. So an earthquake with sinking. One in the east, one in the west, and the third one in Dr. Mansuri, UK. The third one in Arabia. And number 10, you know that the house sank down in Dr. Mansuri, UK? It was Ramadan. You know, but the whole house went down. And number 10, that the fire will come out of Yemen and drive people to their place of assembly. These are the 10 major signs of the last day. Among these, one of the most important is Dajjal. Dajjal is a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who will one day appear in the form of a human being. I'm choosing my words very carefully. He has to appear in the form of a human being because he has been created and given a mission to impersonate the true Messiah. And since the true Messiah is a human being, the only way that Dajjal can impersonate the Messiah is if he appears as a human being. The true Messiah is the Son of Mary, Nabi Isa alayhi salam. And Allah made a promise to Banu Israel that when that Messiah comes, he would rule over from the throne of Nabi Dawood alayhi. And so the golden age of Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam, when the state of Israel ruled over, when the state of Israel was the ruling state of the world. And what's the definition of a ruling state? You must be fully familiar with that by now. A ruling state is one whose rule cannot be rivaled or challenged. That's a ruling state. You don't have to rule every single square inch of KLCC. No. Once you have a rule in the world which cannot be challenged, cannot be rivaled. This was the kind of state that Sulaiman alayhi salam ruled over. The holy state of Israel. And that was the golden age. Zaman Mas. And when the Messiah comes, that golden age will come back one more time. But when Allah sent the Messiah, they rejected him. Some of them believed in him. Why did they reject him? Because they said, وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ هَذَا. He's a bastard. Because his mother was not married when she gave birth to him. And a bastard cannot be the Messiah. And then he could not have been the Messiah because he's dead. Before our very eyes we saw him die on the cross, crucified. He never ruled over. So now it is beyond the shadow of a doubt. He could not have been the Messiah. What they did not know, and what no one knew, not even the government of Malaysia, no one knew, was that no, he did not die. No, he was not crucified. But Allah made it appear like that. What happened? I hope we can discuss that in a lecture to be scheduled on an Islamic view of the return of Jesus alayhi salam. I hope we can do that, inshallah. So we can take up that subject in detail. But Allah raised him. So he never experienced something called maut. And so one day he'll come back to die. Because kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut, every soul must taste hell. But they didn't know that. So they're waiting for the Messiah to come. I lived for 10 years in New York. You can't be in New York and not know that. That the Jews are waiting for the Messiah to come. So Allah created this being. And Allah programmed this being to impersonate the Messiah and gave to him Dajjal, gave to him powers of deception. He can deceive you in anything connected with him. Appearance and reality are opposite from each other. His mission is to rule the world. And when he rules the world with a rule which cannot be rivaled, which cannot be challenged, then he will declare, I am the Messiah. And then he can rub his hands and say, mission accomplished. But that's a tall order to rule the whole world. How are you going to do that? You must come with a very, very, very good strategy if you are to rule the world. The Muslims are not going to accept you. No? Maybe the part-time Muslims, but not the real Muslims. So how are you going to get them to accept you as the Messiah? Not all the Jews are going to accept you. Because there are Jews who are Orthodox Jews. So in order to rule the world, you're going to have to impose a political dictatorship upon all of mankind. Well, I have news for you. That political dictatorship is almost here. You have to have a world government ruling over the whole world. So forget about state sovereignty. When Dajjal says, stand up, the government has to stand. And Dajjal says, sit down, the government has to sit. You don't have freedom anymore. In 1991, the Security Council of the United Nations had to vote on a resolution committing the use of force against Iraq. 91. Cuba was a member of the Security Council. Yemen was a member. China, of course, was a permanent member. Malaysia was a member. And when the resolution came for a vote, Malaysia voted in favor. Although every single Muslim in Malaysia opposed it. Every single one opposed it. Nobody supported it. But the government of Malaysia voted in favor. Yemen voted against or abstained. Cuba voted against. China voted against. But the Muslim state voted in favor. Your prime minister at that time was Dr. Mahathir. And he explained. He said, if we had not done that, they would have destroyed our economy. That was his explanation. So state sovereignty, that was something for the birds. It no longer exists. You now have world government. And that world government is taking you towards a universal political dictatorship. In order for him to rule the world, you must impose a universal economic dictatorship upon man. We are already there. But Dajjal is almost at the conclusion of his mission. It will not be long again before the state of Israel. You know, 15 years ago they used to laugh at me and scoff at me when I said to them that they want Israel to rule the world. Imran, what nonsense are you talking? How can few million Jews in Israel rule the whole world? Huh? Shame on you. They're not laughing anymore now. No. They're swallowing all the laughter they laugh. Israel has to rule the world. And when Israel rules the world, then Dajjal can appear as the ruler of Israel, ruling the world from Jerusalem and declare, I am the Messiah. We're not going to discuss his political weapon tonight. That is the shirk, which is at the very heart of the political state, the new secular state system of the world. Except to say that there is a hadith in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, in which the Prophet warned about his shirk with which he had attacked this ummah. The Prophet said that